Well, I don't know why, but I wanted to go out. I guess I'm sentimental. Hard to believe with my physique. Still, looks can be deceiving, and beneath my bulging muscles hides a little beating heart. Even if sometimes muscles like this bring their fair share of trouble, especially when you're trying to save yourself until you're 20. But that night, I was with the best crew. "Are you ready for the night of your life?" cried my old friend Gary. "Oh, sure, and I'll stay real close to Rock to keep him safe from any aggravation," teased Mona. Clark sighed. "You're so lucky. What a bodyguard." "You gotta admit, knights at the Zooty Slammer get their share of danger," laughed Beryl. Up till now, the only dangers for me had been the crummy singers and the sweet hoofers. I was pretty naive, but I didn't know it yet. "Fun's over, kids," said Gary. "A night to remember starts here."
Thank you.
The guy slugged me so hard, I was seeing whole galaxies. I'm on the ground, and my head's ringing like an old bell. I feel a needle jab, and I figure they're helping me on my way. But a strange feeling takes hold of me, and I cry out. I feel myself drifting off again. My final thought, you're a pretty pair of punks, but I'll be seeing you. I came to inside what looked like a taxi, engulfed by the powerful odor of pipe tobacco. What am I doing here, I said. I was going to ask you the same question, replied a guy, the taxi driver. I patted my pockets. I had everything on me. I'm dressed, I also noted. Well, I should hope so. Seems to me like you've had an unusual night. You've got no idea, my man. What time is it? About 6 o'clock. He looked at me with concern. After a pause, he added, You've got a hell of a bump there, pal. That was an understatement. I was messed up. One eye that wouldn't open, and kidneys that jived with every pothole the damn cab bumped over. But at least I was alive, and far away from those creeps and their electric gizmos. Where did you find me? Was I alone? You were on the ground, flat on your face and out for the count, in an orange grove. You're dang lucky, pal. I like to take a break there before I start my day. It smells good, and the blue chaffinches sing sweetly. Can you take me to town? We're on the way. Lie back against the seat and get some rest. I don't need telling twice. Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, that was a close shave, says Gary, gasping like a landed fish in his seat. It was kind of a boogie, I admit. Do you think those were the same guys who attacked DeFado's wagon, I ask. It's too early to tell, says Gary. One thing we can be sure of, we don't often have such lively nights. That's the least you could say. I know I said the nights at the Zooty Slammer are memorable, but this is a whole other level. Gary continues, let's see what you got. He grabs the envelope that I'd thrown onto the dashboard and rifles through it. I realize fast that it's full of photos. Suddenly, Gary blanches, his jaw clenches. He swallows painfully. Hold on to this, he tells me. I just can't look. What is it? I ask. Photos of operations. He shows me a picture of a guy who looks like a butcher. I won't show you the worst ones. I want to stay on the road, he says. I never imagined you could chop up human flesh like that. There's enough to send the culprit to the chair and put a good many others in the slammer. We're silent for a minute. You don't believe that these are just medical procedures, I say. He gives a mirthless laugh. I've looked at a few of them, he says. This stuff has got a name. It's vivisection, pure and simple. That raises a lot of questions, and I'm not sure I want to hear the answers, but they could lead me to the guys I'm looking for. My apartment is in view. I park and turn off the engine. I put the photos on DeFado's desk. He's got the color back in his cheeks since his early morning investigation. Not for long, though, considering what he's going to find in that envelope. He takes out the first one and doesn't seem shocked. Looking at him, I realize we brought him the proof he's been waiting for.
Thank you.
Gary and I decided to split up, him to the call and me in search of breakfast. I was starving, but I hate eating alone, so I called Douglas to meet me at El Gato. "I'll be right there, my dear Rock," he told me hurriedly. Before he hangs up, I added, "Bring your friend Sunday. She'll be company for us. I can tell my company isn't good enough for you." I could have tried to convince him he was wrong, but why bother? I managed to shake them off, but my passenger decided the ride was over. So Sunday and I went to the call. Do you usually get mixed up in these kinds of cases? She asked me. No, this is a first, but I'm going to see it through. The next minute we were away, looking for Gary. I think that was the last one, Gary shouted to me. Yes, hold on, Gary. We're gonna be okay, I say. When suddenly... Gary! It doesn't take long for Mike and I to find their guys outside the clinic. Frank, who's taken me home, tells me we know where the good doctor is gone. These guys are efficient. Where? An island off the Pacific coast. He sent everything there by freighter. He took all his equipment, his clones, the whole caboodle, he finally said. So, you're going to stop him over there? We're going to stop him, Rock. We need you for the next stage, he tells me, unabashed. I can't believe my lugs, but the guy's serious. For now, go say your goodbyes to your old ma. We'll leave as soon as the plane's ready, he finishes. I nod and turn to the window, my dread struggling against my exhilaration. My revenge is at hand. After that, everything goes without a hitch. We jump one by one. The last one closed the door behind him because we've all been brought up properly. And we came down, each a few yards from the next, our bulky kit swaying on our backs. Thank you. In the midst of the groups, a man appeared who could only be Marcus Schutz. Time to meet the man at the root of this event.
Thank you. Thank you.